This video is going to explore the human ecological perspective of the environment. The term ecology was coined by Ernest Haeckel as a combination of Greek terms referring to the study of the house, the oikos, house, and the logia, study of. Haeckel was a student of Darwin, and Darwin was influenced by Malthus, and we've already talked about Malthus in the presentation on demographic perspectives, so I do think that the ecological perspective is a complementary one to demography, and that's why I treat them together in the same module. And so ecology eventually evolved into different directions, one of those a more biological branch, and one of those the more sociological, social science-based branch. So the focus of human ecology is on how human population evolves with and adapts to the environment. And of course, you can see the influence of Darwinian thinking in that, and we'll see how that is applied by social scientists in particular. But the key here is that when we're talking about adaptation from a social science perspective, human adaptation, what we're really talking about is not genes and biology, but we're talking about culture, and that includes technology. The Chicago School of Human Ecology, in the early part of the 20th century, put together by Albion Small, included a number of important figures in sociological history and was the birthplace of symbolic interactionist perspective and human ecology as a sociological perspective. And the primary concern of the human ecology branch of the Chicago School was with urban space and the changes in spatial patterns and the way that it co-evolved with social life. And so an evolutionary perspective was applied, but not so much with a focus on the natural environment. This was an urban cityscape, and as we'll see, this is more metaphorical than a literal form of thinking about the environment and ecology. Duncan, in the 1960s, a latter descendant, would coin an important idea, the ecological complex, which refers to the POET model, and that is an acronym for population, organization, environment, and technology, and arguably that is one of the most lasting contributions of the ecological perspective. That is still a useful framework for thinking about some of the key interrelated variables when we study society and the environment, of course. Another key idea has to do with more closely the Malthusian idea of limited resources and overpopulation, and so the idea of overshoot was tackled by a shoot-off of human ecology called new human ecology, and that included the work of William R. Catton and Riley Dunlap, who are the founders of this perspective. And this perspective, new human ecology, would eventually morph into what we now call environmental sociology. So you can kind of get a good sense of the intellectual tradition that's going on within the field of sociology here. And the central focus of new human ecology, or environmental sociology, was on environmental problems, and a lot of these ideas were coming out in the 70s alongside on the heels of the environmental movement, the modern environmental movement. And many of the early ideas that were offered by these early thinkers, Catton in particular, was focused on the idea of overshoot. And Dunlap was focused more closely on the notion of the new ecological paradigm in against the backdrop of a human exceptionalist or exceptionalist paradigm, and in fact it was offered both ways at different times. This quote captures some of the basic ideas of this perspective, and it says, "This leads us to define the basic task of environmental sociology as seeking to answer two kinds of questions. A. How do interdependent variations in population, technology, culture, social systems, and personality systems influence the physical environment?" So we can just pause for a second and think about that first one, and I want you to juxtapose that against the POET idea offered by Duncan shortly before it. You could see in the tradition within the ecological paradigm being carried on. The second part of that, how do resultant changes and other variations in the physical environment modify population, technology, culture, social systems, and personality? So this is sort of the interplay between society and the environment. And they go on, Dunlap and Catman, writing about the new ecological paradigm, suggests that this new way of seeing the world is an important one for addressing some of the problems that we're seeing. And so they quote Birch in stating that one thing it seems to make clear is that sociology has to take seriously a dilemma traditionally neglected. Human societies necessarily exploit surrounding ecosystems in order to survive, but societies that flourish to the extent of overexploiting the ecosystem may destroy the basis of their own survival. And that's clearly tied to the Malthusian notion of overshoot, and the latter ideas offered by biological ecologists such as Ehrlich, who we mentioned also elsewhere in the demographic presentation, talking about carrying capacity. And so I like this quote because it also points out that exploitation of the environment to some extent is required. So it's not something that we can totally rid ourselves of. There's no such thing as a free lunch. People need to be fed and clothed and housed and those types of things at a bare minimum require a certain amount of resources. So the new ecological paradigm refers to a cultural idea, more or less, that we're shifting to a new set of values. And we're getting away from this idea that there is such a thing as a free lunch, that humans are exempt from natural processes and laws. And in fact, we're not exempt. And the awareness of our dependence on natural limits, well, that is natural resources that have limits, is an important part of the new ecological paradigm. And as part of the research tradition in the early days of environmental sociology, a great deal of attention was given to measuring the extent to which this new ecological paradigm had become manifest through survey research. And so this particular scale went through some revisions, but this is pretty much the juxtaposition of it. We see 15 items here, and you can kind of get the idea without me reading through all of these what we're trying to measure. But for instance, the first question, we're approaching the limit of the number of people the Earth can support. It's a very Malthusian idea tied to overshoot. Number two, humans have the right to modify the natural environment to suit their needs. That's, of course, going to indicate an exemptionalist way of thinking. Number three, when humans interfere with nature, it produces disastrous consequences. Once again, now we're getting back to knowledge of limits. And so, you know, you kind of see where these items will measure either the new ecological paradigm or the human exceptionalist paradigm. And from this, NEPHEP scale, as that was referred to, has come a number of research studies, and certainly it offers a way of measuring the extent to which society has made the transition into this new way of thinking. And indeed, there's no reason to assume that this will be a linear process, and likely there is going to be some movement in either direction at different times towards the HEP pole or the NEP pole. And these are, of course, going to be bipolar question responses. And that's one of the critiques that people have offered of this scale, that it is a bipolar framework, and many people are critical of that. And others point out that environmental attitudes are often very multidimensional, so to treat it as a two-dimensional scale is also perhaps problematic, and we're not capturing all aspects of environmental concern with these items as listed. It's a very short scale, which is of course the elegance of it, if it's short and sweet, but we're of course sacrificing breadth of topics with that. So this notion of overshoot, one of the hallmarks of living based on a human exemptionalist basis, the idea that we're free from constraint imposed by nature and so forth, was the central concern of William Catton, who wrote a book called Overshoot, and referred historically to an age of exuberance when this notion of manifest destiny was in full swing, and the notion of colonists discovering a new world created the sense of abundance and that natural resources were essentially unlimited. And so this would set the stage for our current culture, to the extent that this paradigm persists. And Cadden notes that this idea of human exemptionalists sort of started to take a turn in the era of post-exuberance, when people began to become aware that there were no more worlds to discover, that the Earth was finite, and that there was a need for a parallel change in our culture and our way of thinking. So the notion of overshoot is now being measured as the difference between our consumption levels and the productive, and I would add absorptive, capacity of the environment, and that has really been captured well by the notion of the ecological footprint. And that is, in fact, one of the best ways to study the actual material side of all this, rather than the ideal, which are the, you know, the social psychological, which is what the HEP-NEP scale measures. And this has received a good deal of attention in the literature, and the IPAT model that we discussed in the demographic presentation turns out to be a very good predictor of ecological footprint. You'll recall that was a combination of population, affluence, and technology is going to, you know, result in a certain type of environmental impacts. So as we'll see, overshoot is empirically linked to both the level of affluence and also urbanization. The additional studies have found links between our footprints and our levels of urbanization. So now we're going to look at some contemporary applications of human ecology. And as it turns out, the contemporary applications take as the starting point the IPAT model, reinforcing this notion that ecology and demography are kind of mutually supportive, perhaps one in the same perspective. A colleague and I sometimes refer to it as a spatial demography perspective. But structural human ecology has developed, particularly at Michigan State. They have an environmental policy center that has really adopted the STIRPAT, which is really just a modification of the IPAT model that we were talking about, and some of the research that has used that I mentioned in order to predict the ecological footprint has provided a good deal of evidence that this is a useful framework, and that population, affluence, and technology are indeed some of the key drivers of environmental impacts. So, as we've changed over time, what we've retained is a continued emphasis on the sheer impacts of population. When you have a lot of people, you're going to use a lot of resources, you're going to produce a lot of waste, and frankly, the environment struggles to keep up. And that idea of overshoot is a critical one, or you can call it carrying capacity, or you can call it the limits to growth. There's a lot of ways to think about it. And of course, cultural awareness and those kinds of things correspond to a realization of these problems, right? So focusing on destructive technologies arguably has received less attention in the empirical literature. The scholars have struggled to find ways to measure the impacts of technology. So to a large degree, even the STIRPAT and IPAT tests have relied largely on population and affluence. And so this notion of affluence remains relevant. And within that IPAT framework, we can see a similar, perhaps, idea in the POET model we mentioned, offered by Duncan now about 5 or 6 decades ago. And so the POET model also remains a good framework, but I have not seen research that attempts to present that in a similar fashion as STIRPAT, although that would be a good innovation, I think. So in summary, the ecological tradition was actually the dominant paradigm in the field of sociology, not just environmental sociology, but for particularly the time of the Chicago School, this was a dominant way of studying society and community in particular. And you can see in this presentation how that evolved into the new human ecology perspective and environmental sociology. So it's really the parentage of the discipline that we're in. And so gradually, we've learned about new ecological paradigm. We've learned about the way that has influenced politics. But essentially what happened in the field of environmental sociology is the political, economic, or conflict perspective has largely sort of taken over. That has become the dominant paradigm. And we'll study that one in another presentation when we look at conflict theories But there's continued focus on population as a control. It's unavoidable that these sheer spatial demographic impacts do matter, and it's unavoidable. So then the question might be trying to figure out how those relate to political and economic forces. So critiques of the ecological perspective, some of the worst problems have occurred where population sizes are small, and that's, as you would guess, probably because those places have a high level of affluence. So the iPad model could perhaps even respond to that critique. But it is true that from a pure demographic perspective, we're going to have problems trying to predict environmental problems solely on the basis of population, because some of the poorest countries in the world have the fastest rates of population growth and relatively large populations, but very small relative ecological footprints to perhaps some wealthy countries where you have very small, stable populations with low growth and high environmental and ecological footprints. And so this is something that can only be explained, I think, when you introduce some of the political economic ideas of the conflict perspective. So the other thing to keep in mind with this one is the physical separation of consumption and production in the global economy. And that is something that the political economy perspective, and particularly the global political economy perspective of world systems theory, unequal exchange, world polity theory, that these have really done a much better job of theorizing and thinking about. Nobody's really adapted to a global scale the ecological perspective, which is another perhaps missed opportunity that could be seen in the near future. And that's going to wrap it up. Thanks for watching.